Hello and welcome to the Steve Calis Show, brought to you by Calis Media. My name is Steve, and I'm joined by my dear friend and comrade, Kevin Harris. Kevin, are you okay?
I'm super pumped for this one.
Yeah, so am I. And it's been a long time coming, hasn't it, this?
Hell, never.
Because the basic rundown is, we recorded this interview weeks and weeks and weeks ago now. It feels like forever ago. And there was a huge issue with our audio, our side of the conversation. It didn't work. It didn't record, or it did record, but it sounded like we were in a fishbowl. So we've had to spend the last few weeks trying to figure out ways to get around it. Now, would you say that the conversation went really well, didn't it? It was a good back and
forth.
It was
a good back and forth. He was a really nice person to speak to.
Yeah, so the issue is we've got the fourth. We've got the back, we just haven't got the fourth. So our half of that conversation is gone. So we've had to re-edit the conversation in the form of a Q&A. Because he gave really, really great detailed answers. So we're going to keep them, keep the crux of his story, and hopefully the message gets across.
So we're cutting out your singing.
I'll add it in later. I'm having a bottle of wine tonight, so I'll add that in extra. But thank you for everyone who's, if you're here, you're listening. Daniel's got a lot to say. He's a brilliantly wise guy. I mean, you said after the interview that you felt like you'd been for like a therapy session. It was
yes, he was very in tune to the.
Yeah, he very, very self-aware, wasn't he?
Mm.
Yeah, and I think there'll be lessons in here for anyone going through any sort of difficult time, because he's had to steer himself through a lot of adversity and massively publicly, which I can't even imagine. So, without further yammering on from me, let's get on with it. This is our Q&A with Danyl Johnson. This is the Steve Calis Show. I'm sat here with Kev. Kev, are you all right?
I'm good.
So here we are. Let's introduce the very handsome Danyl Johnson.
I mean, what an introduction, I have to say. Thanks for that. I especially when you get older. I don't know if anyone calls you handsome anymore. I feel like I had a nearly big birthday in June. It was sort of the penultimate birthday. So yeah, I don't know if you think yourself as handsome. I think you just hate every photograph you're in now because you don't look like you did when you're 21. Thank you so much for asking me to do this. This is awesome. This is very sweet. And I have my own podcast, and I feel like it's quite rare for me to be asked questions because I'm normally the one doing the question asking.
So, Danyl, let's pretend we're doing this like a movie, I think. We want to tell your story, so let's pick it up from this key moment. You are Danyl Johnson, humble primary school teacher. You stood just off stage, just about to perform your first audition. Who are you at this point in your life? How did it come about? And how are you feeling?
Yeah, I mean, it's so funny when people say your whole name. It's like you are being told off like a teacher, like by a teacher. Yeah, Danyl Johnson. I mean, the only other alternative is Peter Dixon saying your name, like, Danyl Johnson. Yeah, so right at the beginning, I was just like, I wouldn't say a humble teacher, because I was doing a multitude of jobs. I was hosting karaoke in Soho, a bar. I was in a wedding band. I worked at Gap part-time in Reading. And I looked after, I was like a manny, so I looked after my friend's kids that are now super big adults, which is incredible, and just very strange when they sort of pick you up from town because you may have drank too much. And then obviously a primary school teacher and worked a lot in drama and sort of stuff with that. And it was one of the students that kind of sort of said to me, I think you should do Xfactor, because we had to sing or something like that. Like teachers had to sing or dance or act or blah, blah. So I sang never knew how much I loved her, never knew how much I care. You know, I love fever in the morning, fever all through the night. So I sang that, and they were like, whoa, I didn't know you could sing. And I was just like, well, you know, thank you for saying that. Anyway, so I went and did that weird thing of having to stand in front of no one. And just producers, and obviously they're not no ones. One of them's Caroline, is a good friend of mine, and I remember just there being thousands upon thousands of people. It was 4 days of auditions that happened at O2, and I was on day two, I think. Stacey Solomon was on day three, Ollie was on day one, and Jamie Afro was on day four. So we're all kind of spread out. And I mean, I haven't even mentioned like Lucy Jones, who smashed it on Eurovision on the year that Brexit was happening. Jed Woods, Joe McKeldry, who won it, who's also won pop star to opera star, and he won the jump because he's very good at skiing. He was on my podcast, Best Thing, not long ago, and I said like any show now that you do, you have to win. So I wanted to do Eurovision because we might win. So then I'll audition for the show, and there's a couple of rounds before, you know, you see the judges. I think there's three rounds, and then the fourth round is a judge. And then I got a call about 2 days beforehand, and they sort of said, what songs are you singing? And you're not going to be singing in just in front of the judges. You're going to be doing it like on Britain's Got Talent, and you're going to have an audience. So think about what you're going to sing. And I had like a couple of songs. I was, you know, karaoke host. So I had a couple of songs that I had that I thought, oh, they might work. And I sang the song that I did in my audition at karaoke like a week before. Am I allowed to swear? Is swearing okay? Yeah. And no one gave a fuck when I sang With a Little Help for My Friends by Joe Cocker, the cover. And I was just like, maybe it's not. But I knew the backing track was great. And then the judges, and I remember being at that day of auditions, like all day, my sister, my best friend, and my other friend Jess, and no one came and spoke to me. It was like I didn't exist. And I asked one of the producers, I haven't been seen, and I've been here for like maybe 6 hours. And they responded with this, are you still here? And I was like, oh, okay. And then I went out and sang for the audience, like I would do at a wedding or all that sort of stuff. But I remember that Dermot and Holly, who were doing Xfactor and Xfactor, they said, oh, when the audition was going on, they turned to my sister and they said, have we done any filming with him? And they were like, nope. They just didn't care. So, yeah. Anyway, that was the story of the beginning, which is incredible.
So when you finish your audition, the response from the judges was great. How did it feel to have Simon Cowell say, that was the best first audition I've ever heard? How was that feeling?
Like, I mean, thank you very much. He's like, he got me to a position of, you know, it's quite hard to get a mortgage. He got me to a position that I could, you know, buy a house, you know, not outright, but like have a mortgage. And that was incredible. So, I mean, no one expects the situation that, you know, you're going to do something and you're going to get that feedback from someone as prestigious as that. Are you right there? Sorry, my dog's just decided to just have some sneezing, so it's fine. Yeah, and so, you know, he was very nice to me.
At that time, X Factor was peak television, and the limelight was on all of you all of the time. Were you happy with how the media portrayed you at that time? Because from the outside, it seemed like you got unfairly cast in the show's narrative as arrogant and cocky, when and actually you were just confident and already polished as a performer.
So one of the things that happened in 2009 is that Twitter had only existed for like 18 months. So it was very, very early. So people weren't really on Twitter. And so the newspapers had a lot of the say about people's personalities, what they liked, what they didn't like. And we weren't allowed the newspapers. So there was no Twitter. We weren't allowed the newspapers. And so we really, in some sort of format, didn't really know what was going on at all. You know, with that, you know, obviously people tell you, and, you know, people have their favorites, and, you know, celebrities that you like go on Xfactor with Holly, and they talk about, you know, who they like, and they like Ollie, or they like Stacey, or they like, you know, Jamie Afro, you know, and so that... You know, that can be hard because there may be people that you love and that they don't really like you for whatever reason. You know, people, you can watch any reality TV star and you watch, you know, The Masked Singer or Strictly, and you would have your favorite. And the other ones, you're like, well, I don't really care about them or like them or whatever. People are doing that on Love Island, you know. So you've just got to take it a pinch of salt. And I'm very lucky that no matter what they kind of threw at me, I was lucky that I was 27. You know, if you're having that when you're 18, 19, 20, 21, I don't know if you've had enough people be horrible to you. Like, but once like you get 27, there's a long line of people that you might have pissed off and they pissed you off. So yes, okay. There is an element of that you can feel that people could be giving you a hard time, But through hard times in your life is the only time you really learn. Like, you never really notice green lights. You only remember red lights. And so you just having these times in your life, good and bad, structure the person you are when you grow up. And you can tolerate so much more. So I think it was harder on my friends and family. So, you know, when someone's horrible to you at school and you can deal with it, but you tell your mum and your mum loses their mind that you're getting a hard time. You're like, no, it's fine. I can deal with it. They've got a really bad home life. You know, like, I understand what's going on, blah, blah, blah. Don't worry about it. It's not every day. But your mom is like, what? They can't do that. And you know, they still hold on. They probably still hate them now. And you're like, mom, it was like 23 years ago. But yeah, so again, did I get a hard time? Yes. Did I get the hardest time? No. Do I still, you know, I look back and when we finished the show, they showed us who won each week. And so the media might not like me, or the judging panel might not want me to win or whatever, but the audience voted crazily for myself, for Joe, for Rachel Adedeji. I think Joe won 4 shows. I won 3. I think Stacey won 1, maybe, and Rachel Adedeji won 1. You know what I mean? So it's all up and down, but who cares? Like, Ollie didn't win any, and now look at Ollie. Like, you know what I mean? Like, smashing life. Stacey Solomon, look, she's more famous now than anyone. Like, she's smashing it to pieces.
What about that showmanship element of your audition? It's been seen tens of millions of times and is often regarded as the best first audition of all time, and you brought that brilliant aspect of yourself into subsequent performances, and suddenly people started calling you cocky. Were you as pissed off about that as I was?
I think the thing is, and I think, you know, most artists or singers that go on the stage have a persona. They always say with comedians, well, you're not very funny off stage. Well, because they're not the person on stage. And it's exactly the same for anyone. I was a primary school teacher. You try and be cocky with a bunch of 8-year-olds, they'll be like, ah, shut up, sir. You know, straight away, like, you're not in charge, you know, whatever. So the thing is I think that my audition was perceived to be this thing of like, oh, he's won. Like, I never thought that. I was just happy to be there. And really, in my mind, I thought it'd be great to make the tour. It's great to be there. 250,000 people auditioned for a year, and I'm in the top 12. I'm sorry. For me, I was just like, well, I've completed life. You know what I mean? It's like me playing FIFA and scoring, you know, like 20 goals against Chelsea. You know what I mean? It's just, it felt amazing. And I am competitive, but when it comes to competitions like that, I'm actually really supportive. And I was really supportive of the people around us. We lived together, we shared rooms together. And so when it comes to people saying I'm just really unlikable or really cocky and stuff like that, I think it was a way to sort of say, what is Daniel's arc going to be? Can it be that? Or does it have to be that? Like, you know what I mean? I heard on Joe Rogan today that someone said, like, watch a surfer surf. It's not straight. He's up and down and it's balancing and, you know, it's really difficult to stay on the board. But you do. And that is life. Like, there are so many different kind of tropes and ebbs and flows and ups and downs and stuff. So for me, you know, there can be some bits when I'm feeling low and I'm feeling a bit upset and, you know, do people like me? But then I have the other side that I just walk out on the street and people just tell me that they watch my audition anytime they feel sad.
So around the semi-final stage, before your X Factor run came to an end, did you have one eye on a record deal, or what was your plan there?
So I came fourth, so I didn't really feel like anything was going to happen. I felt like I probably shouldn't be signed. If I came first or second and they're signing people who came, you know, fourth and fifth, I'd be pretty annoyed. I need them to focus on me. So when they're focusing on Ollie and focusing on Joe, well, that was what needed to happen. But before that, me, Ollie, and Stacey were pushed out to shows for the next 3 years. We played a triple headliner show all over the country for 3 years. And not only did we do that, we also had the biggest tour of 2010. We sold out 57 shows around the UK, selling 500,000 tickets, right? And a lot to do with Jedward, to be honest. I'll give them props for that because they had such a following. Like, it was incredible. they had such a following. And I just felt like a lot of people, I always say this about our cast and our year, that I felt like our year was like the first TOWIE year, you know, with Mark Wright and all those and Jerry Essex, right? The people right at the beginning, they just picked a really good cast. And none of us were scouted, what I know of. You know, all of us were just normal. I don't think there was any sob stories because Stacey was just Stacey. Ollie was just Ollie. Jedward was just Jedward. I was just me. You know what I mean? Like, we were our jobs and not that our guinea pig died.
I quite agree that you had a really fascinating roster of talent that year. And I actually think that you guys set a personality benchmark that the X Factor would try to replicate in the seasons that followed. Suddenly there was much more impetus on characters and personalities and life stories. Is that how it seems to you now in hindsight?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. And I think I think the three powerful years, and this is nothing against anyone else who won in these years, because we had some great years with James Arthur and Little Mix, right? Smashing it, and Louisa Johnson, Ben Haynow. But for me, was the Alexandra JLS year before us, our year with Ollie and Stacey and Joe, and then the year afterwards was the most star quality version of the show there has ever been, because Matt Calder won it, Rebecca Ferguson came second, One Direction came third, and Cher Lord came fourth. They had Wagner, they had Tesco Mary, they had all these names in there, Casey Wazel, you know, they had all these names that people, Gamu, who didn't even make the show, you know, like, and that's a funny thing about X Factor compared to most other reality TV shows. So many people have been successful. Has it been successful ever or doing singing all the way through? No. But look at Rylan. You know what I mean? Look at what Stacey has done. That's not through singing. That's using their personality and just being fantastic. Then you look at One Direction and all their solo work. You look at Little Mix. You look at Ollie Murs. You look at Leona Lewis. You look at, you know, James Arthur, who I think is an incredible artist. You know, you look at these people, Ella Henderson and stuff like that. It's just bang, 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 bang. And I'm not throwing shade at any other show. And I'm not going to say any other show's name, but what other show does that?
How do you feel looking back on your experiences now? How do you personally reflect on the highs and lows now that some time has passed?
I think, you know, I talk about stuff about self-appreciation and liking yourself and stuff like that a lot. And out of anyone that you would have ever met in your entire life, I guarantee the biggest bully to you is yourself. And so when you have people say stuff, because it's really difficult, because theoretically speaking, you might just say, I'm the person I think I am. But if no one else thinks that, then you're not. You know what I mean? You're actually normally you're the person that people think you are. So if people think you're flaky, or if people think you're very polite, or if people think you're very helpful, and you don't think that, well, you probably are those things. You know what I mean? So for me, when people sort of come up to me in the street and they talk about, you know, that moment, I always think it's not me. I feel like they're just talking to someone else. I feel like I'm making it up. I feel like I live in a simulation, and this is all just part of the game. And, you know, that's not really real. The people I met, all the things we did and all that stuff, like, it's incredible to think that me, some dickhead from Reading, you know, love Reading, of course, I'm just saying I'm a dickhead. But, you know, so is getting this adulation and getting this kind of like fanful, like my picture was on the side of a hotel. Now, I never saw this because the support of Reading. Like, I wasn't from Essex or Glasgow or Liverpool or Manchester or Newcastle. I wasn't from big cities. I was from a great town who just literally grabbed hold of me. And I you know, I work very closely with loads of different charities and things that happen in Reading, and I have never charged for my time with them, because I feel like I still need to pay back them for the support they gave me, which is now 11 years ago. And I don't think I'll ever feel like I've paid it back, because I don't think I deserved it. But, you know.
So how is 39-year-old Danyl Johnson different to the 29-year-old X Factor famous Danyl Johnson? Did the success change you in any way?
I don't think it ever changed me. I never grew up with money. I've never been abroad with my family. and we went to Cornwall, and that was more than enough. Like, you only know what you know. And I've never judged myself against other people. I've only judged myself really against me. And I think that that's how you don't give yourself too much of a hard time, that you're not doing the same things as everyone else. And so being 39-year-old, Dan, I'm in like such a happy place. And like, actually, do you know what? I'm in a really content place. Happiness is like the elements of like the sprinkles on top of an ice cream. I'm like the ice cream right now. Like, I feel like really, really like happy. Stuff happens every day that stresses you the hell out and can make you feel terrible in those moments. But afterwards, you learn something, you move on, and it's gone. And, I've had opportunities. I did a cameo in Benidorm in 2011, which was amazing, and made some really good friends and got to work with Steve Pemberton, who I love from Inside Number 9 and League of Gentlemen and stuff like that. Huge fan. And then, I got to do a You Decide with my friend Lucy Jones, who represented for Eurovision, and I had a chance of doing that. And I couldn't have been more happy that she got it.
Through your life experiences, your podcasts, etc., you've been on a real journey of self-discovery and development. It's clear that you're in a really good place, which is brilliant, because I think being under that much scrutiny would have driven me completely mad.
I have now... I achieved my dreams, guys. Like, anyone who gets to do that, no one ever asks, like, if you make your dreams come true, what is your next dream? And I guarantee nearly no one knows that. Because not many people fulfill them. So I didn't reach for further than I could reach. I got further than I could ever imagine my 13-year-old self, that when I was at school writing songs and being, performing and just being told to shut up by the neighbor for singing. If I could have just showed them what I would have gone on to have done, their mind would have been blown away, and all the people we met. And so for me doing my job now, people might be like, oh, it's a step down and he's doing like some adverts for some lottery and like he should be like singing and stuff like that. Well, do you know what? In the last 18 months, there hasn't been any singing. You know what I mean? There hasn't been any singing. It didn't exist. So for me and Stacey and Ollie that have jobs that is not to do with singing and can still carry on, and like I call myself a glorified Keith Chegwin, and I love Keith Chegwin. He's such a lovely, lovely, lovely man. But you know what I mean? Like, you might want to take the mick out of people's jobs, but the element of that I get to tell people every day they've won money. I get to hone my skills and learn a new craft of presenting, which is not easy. You know, I'm dyslexic, so I find learning scripts and all that stuff really difficult, but I find my way around it.
Danyl, tell us a little bit about your podcasts. They're brilliant. One is called Best Thing. It's positive and uplifting and really easy listen. The other is called Little Help, which is a daily 2-minute thought-provoking, perspective-enhancing nugget of a show. How are the podcasts going from your point of view, and how have you found the experience?
It's so stressful having a podcast. Oh my goodness. So stressful. I mean, it comes off the bat because I had a radio show with just local BBC Radio Berkshire, and I took, when I left there after a year, and it wasn't a bad thing, we decided just to not renew, and I took everyone else to do with the podcast, including the producer for series one, and I still wanted to work with them, I still wanted to do stuff, and I still wanted to come up with concept. And then the coronavirus hit, and then I felt like everyone was just really sad, and everyone's watching the news. And I thought, I had a song that I'd written ages ago with a great singer-songwriter called Tom Baxter. And we wrote a song called Best Thing. And I thought, well, why don't we just talk about people's best things in their life? And I thought, well, we'll keep it really vague. So everyone likes food. So what's the best thing about food? What's the best thing about traveling or TV and film and music? And then maybe they can choose their own. So we have something random. And, I started off and I just asked a load of people. And someone I knew. And some I didn't know. And there's a soul singer that I have loved for freaking ages. And his name is Connor Reeves. And he was just so freaking awesome. If you don't know him, listen to his music. He's incredible. And I said, oh, would you do my podcast? And he was like, yeah. So he did like episode 2. And I was like, I'm sorry, what? And then it's just grown. And then we got like Joe from S Club. We've had Ben Haynell. Then we had Peter Dixon, the voiceover guy. We had a journalist called Johan Harry. And I don't know Johan at all. I, I followed him, and then a year before he sort of said, oh, can you help me with picking something out? I was like, yeah. And I think he was just asking anyone who had a blue tick on Twitter. And then I was just like, oh, do you fancy doing my podcast? He's like, I'm writing a book right now, which is going to be out soon, apparently. I'm writing a book now, but when it's done in December, yeah. And he kept to his word, and I went and met him in London, and now we're friends. You know, and I saw him on Joe Rogan, and he's doing my little podcast. We did an extra long special, so it was like an hour and a half, an hour 40-minute special. And I coach a football team as well, and under 15s they are now. And I put it on the thread to just for the parents to listen. And they, the parents told their kids to listen to it, and I didn't know this. And then, I mean, Johan doesn't hold back. And there's a lot of swearing. There's like talking about like German fisting houses. Like it's fully on but podcasts, I listen to stuff all the time. Loads of it goes over your head. And he was just fascinating person. And I don't have favorites that did the podcast, but I do have people that I inspire to, you know and learn from, even if I ever meet them or not. And we're just working on series 4, which looks like we're going to be filming it for YouTube as well. And I'm going to go and visit where we're going to be filming, and we're just putting together cast list. And already I just reach out on Twitter and say, do you fancy doing it? And I always say to myself, you might not say yes for series 1 or series 7 or series 22, but for series 57 you might say yes.
So finally, Danyl, what are the main takeaways from your personal development so far? What do you try and stay mindful of in your day-to-day life?
I've got another podcast, and it's called Little Help, and it's just 2 minutes every single day, and it's just little pick-me-ups. And I did it because I've been writing these stuff for ages, and I'm supposed to be going to schools and colleges, but it really came from me being a teacher. And I'll quickly just tell you a quick story. There was a kid who was getting really horribly bullied at school. And we were trying to sort it out, and we're talking to the person who's bullying, and we're talking to the person who's getting bullied. And so I asked the person who's getting bullied a series of questions, and I said, if you could choose to be bullied at home or at school, tough choice, but where would you rather be bullied? And they said, well, I wouldn't want to be bullied at home. That'd be horrible. I'd rather be bullied at school. I was like, okay. Do you have anyone at home that helps you with your homework? They're like, yeah. I was like, cool. Do you ever go on holiday with your parents or guardians? They're like, yeah. I was like, do you get told that you're loved and have hugs? And I asked them quite a few questions, and they said yes to every single one. And I said, the person that is giving you a hard time, when I asked them the same questions, they said no to every single question. And that kid from that moment wasn't the victim anymore. They saw a completely different side. And not saying this works all the time, but sometimes in situations, you may feel like you might be holding the worst hand ever. But I always say this, if you choose anyone that you know, and you actually personally know, I guarantee you wouldn't want to swap places with anyone else. You would have your life, because you have to take their baggage as well. It's not just their life that you see, it's everything else. It's their family, their friends, their relationships, everything. Everything that's happened, good and bad. Your life is good enough. You were good enough. And there's always going to be people that are not going to appreciate you. Just see them. And I think Joe Rogan says that. He just thinks as everyone is babies. He's like, you used to be a baby once. You used to be a baby. Like, I'm not going to take you and be a victimized from you because life hasn't gone the way you want it, because you're not getting the love that you need. You're not getting the help that you need. You're struggling at school and you're getting bullied at home. And I always say this, kids, and I'll shut up in a second, but I always say this, the first question that I always ask if I go to school is, I'm like, right, put your hand up if you've ever been bullied. And then everyone's got their hand up. They're like, yes, me, I've been bullied. I was like, cool. I said, put your hand up now if you've ever bullied anyone. There's very few people that put their hand up. And I'm like, okay. I actually hadn't finished the question. The question was, put your hand up if you ever bullied anyone, including brothers and sisters. And then you watch everyone put their hand up. Because that's the thing. You are always giving someone a hard time, or talking about them behind their back, or not being the best version of you. You just may not see it, you may not know that you might be causing someone the worst grief that they're going to carry for the next 25 years. So sometimes you just got to watch your actions, but also don't be motivated by your life is worse than anyone else's, because normally it definitely isn't. If you go through life always worrying about what happened to you, you won't make your life any better. You need to still go through, you know, those sort of stages of sort of grief or whatever it is. But honestly, if you live in the past, you know, you just learn from the past. Don't live in the past. Honestly, I have such a lovely job and I feel so secure even through this time of, you know, that's not been great. And honestly, I am so content. And don't worry, I still have days I'm like, oh my God, shittest day ever. But I need those. I need that. I need those punches in the face sometimes, because it reminds me of when things are good. And when things are good, live in it. And when things are bad, just figure out how you're going to get back to content. Don't worry about being happy or being good. Just worry about getting content, because it's only one step. Bad, content, happy. You know, that's it.
Okay, mate. Well, it was so good of you to join us. One day, Calis Media will be a household name and a producer of some of the UK's best audio content. And having you on as a guest will go some way to helping us achieve that. So thank you.
Yeah, it was a bit of a pleasure talking to you.
Let's next time do it in person. I feel like that'll be cool. So maybe we'll get you to come in the studio and we'll do something. But good luck with everything you're doing in the future. I'm loving your work. I think it's really good. I loved your last episode as well, Steve. I thought it was like really insightful, and sometimes I need to hear people, even if I don't agree how they deal with stuff, I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, I wouldn't do it like that, but maybe I should. You know, I think that's great. I never think I'm right. Even there's always something wrong in something right, and there's always something right and something wrong. So you never think you have the answer. Never think you were right, because you're probably a little bit wrong.
Whew, Kev, it's done. With the episode is done. All of our trials, our Herculean trials, are complete, and the episode's now out there. How do you feel?
I'm not sure until it's actually out there. Yeah. I'll withhold my glee.
Yeah, then we wait for to see how people receive it. But I mean, his story's brilliant. We didn't really need much of us in there, but we awkwardly recorded our questions again anyway. So yes. So that was an ordeal, but it's done.
I do apologise for what sounds like a very robotic.
Hey, no, your delivery is beautiful. Daniel Day-Lewis-esque, in fact, I'd say.
Oh, thank you.
That's all right. So, yeah, it's done. Let's get it out there. Thank you all so much for listening to this episode. If you've made it through to the end, we really, really appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you for your patience.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah, it's good of you. If you can head over to Facebook, Instagram, and follow at Calis Media, Calis Media. That's where you find all the Steve Calis Show and our Pokemon Quest content. That's where we post most of our stuff. So, that's it. That's it from me. Oh, and one more thing. At the moment, we're working a lot with local businesses. You would have seen our promotion with the big cheesecake, the cheesecake business, which was great. We had an episode with Kirsty. We've given away a lot of free cheesecakes. And over the next 6 months or so, we hope to work with a lot more local businesses. So if you want to come on the show, talk to us and do a promotion and team up with us, then just let us know. Drop us an email. Or
if it's a business, if it's an event, anything you want to promote, just get at us on
the, we'll sell stuff.
Calis Media.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we'll promote some shit. So thanks again, guys. Yeah, well, no, we really appreciate it. And goodbye.
Goodbye.